Hello and welcome. I'm your host, and this is 35 Fox Talks. In this episode, we will be providing an introduction to the joint targeting cycle. Now, over the past few months, we've been building these episodes along the TRADOC date storyline of Denovia. We've provided a situation briefing to the command and staff, received requests for more information, and started a discussion on how analysts can understand military strategic forces. It is at this moment, here as in reality, that operations and fires planners will want lists of targets so that they can start preparing for possible operations and effects. Some analysts will push back and say it's too soon to submit targets because they haven't fully assessed the emerging situation, while others will just start making up targets willy-nilly because they think targets are any military thing identified in reporting. All of this begs two questions. What is targeting, and at what point in JIPOE do we start it? The answer to what is targeting can be found in Joint Publication 3-60. For this episode, we will use the 2013 version because the newer version requires a CAC for access, so we're going to leave that one alone and use the publicly available version of the document. Quote 1. Targeting is the process of selecting and prioritizing targets and matching the appropriate response to them, considering operational requirements and capabilities. Quote 2. The joint targeting process categorizes adversary threat elements into target systems, target system components, targets, and target elements. Quote 3. A target is an entity, a person, place, or thing considered for possible engagement or action in order to alter or neutralize the function it performs for the adversary. A target's operational importance is determined by conducting an assessment to determine if engaging the target is consistent with planned operations and will help achieve the commander's objectives and end state. Quote 4. Further defined, a target is an entity or object that performs a function for the adversary, considered for possible engagement or other action. Standard types of targets are facility, individual, virtual, equipment, or organization. The answer to when does targeting begin starts with where it begins. According to doctrine, joint forces are established at three levels: unified commands, or COCOMs, subordinate unified commands, and joint task forces. When they are assigned battle space and military end states, joint forces have inherent target intelligence production responsibilities, which means target development is primarily the responsibility of the joint force, who have to manage partnerships to leverage appropriate expertise. You see, this means there's no real start of targeting. Targeting is constantly cycling because we have permanent joint commands who have primed the pumps of targeting with valid military targets that support contingency plans and crisis action plans. Now, we provided the framework of this in our Chilling with a Fox number 2 video on JOPES, JPEZ, APEX, and TIBFID, along with our video on the joint force structure of the U.S. military. What does all this mumbo-jumbo mean to you as an analyst? First, if you're at a joint command of a combatant command, a unified subordinate command, or a joint task force, it's your job to have targets ready for recommendation at a moment's notice. Second, if you're a unit being activated into an O-plan or a crisis action plan, your initial targets come from your higher headquarters in that thing called an op ward. Now, we're not saying those op wards have every target your unit will have to deal with, but it's your start point. Third, from that point forward, your unit-specific JIPOE will confirm, deny, or identify new targets that support the accomplishment of your unit's mission. Now let us turn to the question, when does the targeting process start? Answer, at the receipt of mission, with the target list from higher headquarters. Next question, when does your unit identify targets unique to its area of responsibility? Answer, as soon as you hit the military variable of JIPOE Step 1, which immediately starts JIPOE Step 3, where one of the things you generate as an analyst is a high-value target list, or HVTL. For anyone wondering why we skipped JIPOE Step 2, remember in the JIPOE video we did, We told y'all we could do JIPOE steps 1 and 3 at the same time, and there's the proof. Getting back to targeting, it's worth a mention here that what we've covered so far might not be the way you've experienced targeting. That's because in the global war on terrorism, most of us experience the bottom-up refinement of pre-approved targets and target categories. Most of us didn't see the initial joint targeting coordination that occurred in the years of 2001 and 2003. You see, GWAT targeting was a section of joint targeting repeated over and over again at high speed, but it wasn't the entire process. Well, for most of us, that is. Exercises like CTC rotations and warfighters have a similar limitation. The condensed timeline of these exercises means they only give you a brief view of certain steps of targeting before the exercise ends. Few are the number of people who truly know the whole military targeting process enough to articulate it in academic spaces while also being able to adapt its tenets in operational spaces. This includes us making these videos. Remember, it is taking a team to bring together enough experience to provide this walkthrough. To make targeting an analogy, we're going to compare it to an analog wind-up wristwatch. The whole watch represents the joint targeting process. From the outside, it seems like a simple one-piece device. When you ask someone to tell the time, easy. When you ask someone to change a date or adjust the time, easy. But when you ask someone how the watch works, or how to build one, faces get contorted in confusion. If you take the back off of one of these watches, you can see how intricate and complex the process of telling time is. This watch analogy is how you should think of targeting. When well organized, targeting is as easy as adjusting the time on a well-made watch. But when targeting is cobbled together, it is as aggravating as troubleshooting the internal gears of an old, rusted watch. You see, in our analogy of the joint targeting process being like the workings of a watch, every component of a watch represents a person or organization. Some drive the watch hands, others the date, others the chronograph, etc. They are all part of targeting, but not themselves. Targeting. Make sense? What kickstarts the entire process is the mission, mission statement, and commander's guidance. In our analogy, this is equivalent to the stem winding the main spring, which then powers all the other movements of the watch. If you are one of the gears and try to spin without being driven by the main spring of the mission, you're either spinning freely in a broken watch, or you're going to be exerting a lot of effort against a system that is not in motion. If the watch is running and you're a gear who misunderstands their position and goes on an independent effort, you're going to affect the effectiveness of the entire watch. Okay, enough philosophy. Let's look at the internal mechanics of the joint targeting process. And here we have it, the joint targeting cycle, enveloped by the cycle of intel cycles, allowing intel to support operations, ISR, and targeting. Within the joint targeting cycle, we have these phases and their subcomponents. Phase 1, commander's objectives, targeting guidance, and intent. This phase outlines the commander's end state, intent, objectives, and tasks. This in turn initiates centers of gravity, or COG analysis. This analysis is an effort to determine the enemy's strategic and operational sources of power that allows them to effectively function in the operational environment. As analysts conduct COG analysis, they identify the critical capabilities that enable COGs to function, critical requirements that are essential to the operation of critical capabilities, and ultimately the critical vulnerabilities of the adversary's entire center of gravity system. As we can see here, often there's overlap between strategic and operational centers of gravity. This means some critical capabilities and critical requirements may be shared between centers of gravity, which makes them very likely to be critical vulnerabilities. Now, once COG is complete, initial targets to defeat the COG are recommended and priorities of targeting are established. What everyone should exit phase 1 with is clear MOPs and MOs, targeting priorities, and initial collection requirements for target development. Phase 2. Within this phase, the goal of analysts is to characterize potential targets or revalidate existing targets that support the commander's objectives. The deliverables from this phase are target systems analysis, entity-level target development, and management of target lists. Now, in looking at COG analysis, we saw that typically the critical vulnerabilities identified will be general systems like air defense or perception management or railroads or petroleum production, etc. This means that to effectively target COG critical vulnerabilities, you must understand the system the critical vulnerability is comprised of and take it apart piece by piece. To do that, analysts conduct target system analysis, or TSA. TSAs are composed of identifying the target systems and target system components. Systems are typically a broad set of interrelated, functionally associated components that generally produce a common output or have a shared mission. Their real importance lies in their relationship to other targets within an operational system. System components are typically a set of targets belonging to one or more groups of industries and basic utilities required to produce component parts of an end product, or one type of a series of interrelated commodities. Once you have these identified and their links or interconnections outlined, you've completed your target system analysis. And once you've completed your TSA, you can identify actual targets, which, defined, is an entity, person, place, or thing considered for possible engagement or action to alter or neutralize the function it performs for the adversary. From here, you identify target elements, which are things within a target that can be used to gain access, disintegrate, or destroy a target. Now, once you nominate new or revalidate existing targets, as an analyst, you go get with fires planners and work the process of target list management. Now, there are multiple target lists out there that support different requirements and different effects. The best people to talk to about what target lists are and what they're used for are your fires personnel, typically a 131 Alpha, a 13 Alpha, or a senior fires non-commissioned officer. Now, at first look, this all seems redundant and confusing because we seem to have four classes of targets, but only one class can be an actual target. Looking into this quandary reveals this is done because modern threat systems are so large and complex they can't be targeted all at once. They have to be steadily taken apart through multiple methods over time. Because the DoD recognizes the confusing nature of this setup, they have developed standardized target system categories. From the time these target system categories were established until about 2005-ish, they were the only ones that existed. Once GWAT shifted into high gear, the Joint Targeting Community approved the CTAF target system categories. Now, unfortunately, almost immediately many analysts and fires planners broke the categories in the left into target systems that support conventional warfare, and what's on the right, they broke those into target systems that support irregular warfare. This misconception of conventional versus irregular warfare is something we hope our last episode helped reduce or eliminate in the minds of many analysts. Now that we're in the era of so-called great power competition, many service members new to joint targeting are looking for the great power competition target systems framework. This itself is another misconception. You see, in our operational environment videos, we outlined how great power competition has always existed. Therefore, any target systems categories that we developed in the past are very likely to apply to great power competition. For example, all these target systems on the left were developed during the 44-year-long Cold War between the superpowers of the U.S. and Soviet Union. They were developed when two great powers were competing for global influence. Sounds a lot like great power competition. Now, if you as an analyst think these are not effective enough, you can just add in the applicable CTAF categories to your efforts. Combined, these two target systems constructs appeared to cover 90% of all modern target system categories. All that said, these target system categories are helpful in compartmentalizing problems. However, they are still too large to be defeated, neutralized, or destroyed in a few negotiations or kinetic strikes. That's why they are not targets themselves, but targeted systems. From these systems, five target types are developed for actual target planning. These types go by the acronym 5-0. Facilities, individuals, virtual targets. See, cyber is in there, no need to go inventing things. Equipment, and organizations. To make more sense of this, let's go to a practical example. Here we see the target system petroleum industry. Its doctrinally defined target system components are crude wells, infield collection, pumping stations, liquids, gasoline plants, natural gas wells, pipelines, tars, bitumen coke, kerosene's cracking, reforming, blending, storage, and end product shipping. From this, we can develop targets such as, making this up, the Acme oil field, the refinery number 1234, the fill-in-the-blank storage station, Bob the oil chief financial officer, and on and on. Some of the target elements of these targets are the number one oil well for the Acme oil field, the network control system for the refinery, the valves at fill-in-the-blank oil station, and the corporate accounts of Bob. So as you can see, phase two of the joint targeting cycle is chock full of intel production requirements. Hopefully you also see how important it is to identify where targets exist within a target system so we can evaluate how your unit's targets impact the target system, thereby exploiting a critical cog vulnerability and thereby destabilizing the adversary's center of gravity. If you as an analyst just start slinging targets, you're probably going to do very little to defeat an adversary. As Sun Tzu said, tactics without strategy is the noise before defeat. So develop your targets within the joint targeting process to have a strategy. Please. Cycling forward to phase three, we see that things become more operations focused with commander's decision and force assignment. In this phase, the commander approves the high payoff target list and the staff begins planning effects that are lawful and proportional, effective, efficient, in line with the mission and commander's intent, weighs available forces with courses of action, and estimates the effects of attacks. You see the entire point in this phase is weaponeering, choosing the right platform with the right payload to achieve desired outcomes while seeking to avoid collateral damage against non-combatants. Phase 4 continues the operations-focused trend, with operations getting the right people and equipment into place, while the role of intel here is generally focused on getting the right ISR into place at the right time. Phase 5 and 6 require their own video because these are the phases of execution. The methods of execution are known to many. They range from the very deliberate method of decide, detect, deliver, and assess, known as D3A, to the very reactive and dynamic find, fix, track, target, engage, assess, F2T2EA methodology. And it is here in phases 4 through 6 that most of us have lived our GWAT and exercise lives. We've gotten accustomed to getting existing targets, then aligning assets against them, executing missions, exploiting objectives, assessing the evolving situation, identifying new targets within pre-approved target categories, and cycling the process again. So looking back at our Black Sea region date scenario, all of this joint targeting information now allows us to know that because there is one or more O-plans prepared for Denovia, there are existing pre-planned targets for the strategic forces. There are also supposed to be existing COGs and TSAs for us to update and reference. When we do a rapid crosswalk of traditional and CTAF target systems to the Strategic Forces org chart, we see that Missile Command is double booked under WMD and Ballistic Missiles, Space Command is under Space Force Systems, Strategic Communications Command is under C4I, and the Intelligence Directorate is under traditional C4I, along with being under CTAF's intelligence. Now, InfoWar Command is a touch wonky because there seems to be no purpose-built targeting category for it. However, it can be coaxed into C4I and or CTAF's ideology category. In conclusion, you see you don't have to hunt for targets or start the targeting process. Targets already exist and the targeting process is always running. You just have to take existing data and refine it. And to refine it, you need knowledge and collection. And collection is the topic of our next episode, where we will be looking at confirming threat disposition. Until then, stay safe and God bless.